मेजरमेंट ऑफ द जीन एक्सप्रेशन लेवल वन मस्ट मेजर द ट्रांसलेशन ऑफ एमआरएनए. सो फॉर दैट राइबोसोम प्रोफाइलिंग इज डन एंड इन दैट वी अरेस्ट द ट्रांसलेशन एट ट्रांसलोकेशन स्टेज यूजिंग सम ड्रग लाइक साइक्लोहेक्सिमाइड एंड आफ्टर दैट द सेल्स आर ब्रोकन आफ्टर द ड्रग ट्रीटमेंट एंड दे आर सेंट्रीफ्यूज्ड यूजिंग सुक्रोज ग्रेडियंट एंड after that the centrifugation the fractions basically which contain the ribosome they are basically degraded treated with the RNase 1 so the sites which are protected with the ribosome they are protected from this digestion with RNase 1 and after the centrifugation they are isolated by gel purification or we can also quantify them using northern blot or RT-PCR so and even we can perform the RNA sequencing also to know the sequence of that part which are translated during using that transcription factor or
like you have read a few things here and there from where did you read about the cyclohexamide sucrose gradient etc
sir Watson
okay the answer is still not there but at least you are in the right direction anybody else koi kuch padhai nahi kar raha hai पता चल रहा है ठीक है व्हाट वाज द अदर क्वेश्चन आई आस्क्ड टू क्वेश्चंस
सर दैट वाज आंसर्ड ऑन दैट डे ओनली
ओह आई मेड द मिस्टेक अच्छा सो ओके एनीथिंग एल्स
Sir, in eukaryotes, in the 43 initiation complex during the initiation of translation, you said in the Kozak sequence, the A nucleotide at the -3 position is important. So if we mutate the A or any other nucleotide in the Kozak sequence, how it will affect? Or will it affect also because it is not so important?
Yeah, like it is... you know, like my experience is it does not make a whole lot of difference.
Okay. So even if you mutate the A nucleotide at the -3, it will not make much a difference.
That's my experience. But, you know, textbook says Kozak consensus is very important. So that's what you are supposed to know. Okay. But I will not ask you questions. So this is, yes. In US military, they have a rule called don't ask, don't tell.
Yes.
I will not ask, I will not tell.
Sir, and one more thing I want to ask. Ah, sir, like polysomes, like where you know multiple ribosomes are there on the single mRNA. So when like one ribosome is translating the one stretch, like a particular stretch of mRNA. Will there be no, you know, clash between the two ribosomes? Like how it is regulated?
Meaning
in the sense like on, like we have a mRNA of like 4 kilobases. Now, if there are like 4 ribosomes on it, so will there be no clash between two ribosomes when they are translating? In the polysome form,
they will not all move in the same speed, so they will be, you know, it's like Mumbai suburban lines.
Okay, sir. So it is like well coordinated, and that's why there is no problem in that.
Oh.
Sir, regarding this codon anticodon binding, imagine this the first two codons and second three anticodon, they match perfectly, but the vobos at vobos position, there is not the perfect matching. And in case of for example C pairs with U, sir, this this pairing, it is sir because of formation of hydrogen bonds, sir.
It is non Watson-Crick based pairing, but yes, hydrogen bond,
sir. But actually, sir, U pairs with two hydrogen bonds and G pairs with
yeah, so you cannot analyze that bonding in the light of Watson-Crick based pairing, right? These are non-Watson-Crick based pairing bonding. So, and you know, I am not deeply knowledgeable about structural aspects, so I will not be able to give you an insightful answer to that. Yes, Navneet.
Okay, sir.
You asked that day. So, is it possible that when the transaction factor is bound to the ribosome, it's of a different type, and then a different Schwellenberg constant, and then when it is transformed with a
Navneet, your voice is very poor. Can you do something? I cannot hear you. I don't know about others.
So we also cannot.
Ayush, go ahead.
Sir, I was not able to hear Navneet, so let me continue the answer for the question that I read. So for detecting if so the question was that if a transcription factor or the translation factor X is responsible in translating a particular protein, how will we detect
a particular protein, a set of proteins?
Yes, so how will we detect if it is able to translate or not, right?
No. Question is, imagine there is a translation initiation factor X,
okay,
which is responsible for translation of only a subset of mRNAs.
Okay.
How would you identify the subset of mRNAs that require X for their translation?
So for this, what we can do is we will use two set of experiments, one used as a control and one is experiment. And in one, in the control, we will use the wild type cells, and in the experiment, we will use the mutated cell. Then we will prepare the lysates from both of them and perform sucrose gradient centrifugation for the separation of polysomes and the 40S and 60S ribosomal subunits, as well as the 80S ribosomal subunits. And after that, we will detect them using some blotting technique. Like if we are using some technique to detect the presence of the protein, and if we found if we find that the presence of protein in 40S subunit and in the polysome fraction, and as well as in 80S but not in 60S, then it indicates that it is found in the control fraction but not in the experimental fraction. So this indicates that that factor is acting as an initiation factor for the translation of those set of proteins.
Well, like you traveled a little farther than Monica, but still you could not connect the last two dots.
You
will see that it is so easy.
Okay. One thing that is confusing for me as well is that how will we detect that which set of proteins is being translated by the factor?
What is
polysome? How can we predict that?
What is a polysome?
A polysome a polysome is a I mean a multiple ribosomes that are bound to an mRNA and involved in the translation process simultaneously.
Of
that particular mRNA. I mean, right. The protein from that particular mRNA.
Okay. So, in the absence of a translation factor, if a certain mRNA is not being translated, will it be in the polysome?
Okay. Right. So, we will not detect that in the polysome section. But okay, so it will not be there in 40S as well as 60S and 80S and polysome, and in the control fraction it will be there.
Yeah. So you don't need to identify the protein. You can identify the mRNA present in the polysome or the absence of it.
Okay. So we will use some RNA-based technique, detection technique instead of protein-based. Like northern blotting or RT-PCR.
See, northern blotting or RT-PCR will demand that you know which RNA it is.
Right, that is the confusion that we have to differentiate. So
simply do a chipsec. I meant
microarray. Microarray.
So, if you take a wild-type cell and a cell mutated for translation factor X, and you grow them. And then, as Monica suggested, that you grow them in the end for last 15, 20, 30 minutes in presence of cyclohexamide, which freezes the polysomes on their track. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now you lyse the cells. And what Navneet was also trying to say, but unfortunately his connection is not good. Then you separate them on a sucrose gradient. You will be able to see a separate peak for 40S, 60S, 80S, and polysomes.
Yes, sir.
Now, actively translating mRNAs are only in the polysome.
Yes, sir.
So you simply isolate the polysome fraction from control and from the test.
Okay.
Isolate total RNA from there and do a microarray.
Okay, sir.
How complicated was it?
Not much. Just that we had to know the basic concept. I mean, the clarification must be there.
Shreya, were you trying to say something?
Yes, sir. Like I was saying, trying to add, but then I realized it might not be useful in this aspect. Like I was saying that in varying time periods, if we can measure the radioactivity. So since if an mRNA is being translated, so we'll have varying length of polypeptides. So the incorporation of radioactivity will increase with time. So then by that, but then I realized it will give us the proteins which are translated and not the...
Yeah, Navneet?
Yes, sir. I have a few questions. Can you hear me now?
Slightly better. Speak little loud. We'll try.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, speak little louder and let us try.
Okay, sir. So, my first question is, in the polysomes, it happens like the translation process happens. So, how does the initiation occur for other polysomes?
I'm sorry, Navneet. Really, I cannot hear anything.
Sir, you can write in the chat box.
Yeah, if you can write in the chat box. Okay. Let me ask a question to Ruchira.
Yes, sir. Yes. Okay.
So, I am giving you a fact that once, like you can grow cells in a culture, and then you can expose the cells to ligand of a signal transduction pathway. Okay, it can be ligand for GPCR pathway, it can be BMP signaling pathway, it can be a cytokine, whatever. Then multiple things happen, but one common path is, let me share the screen. Hold on. Too many things are open.
Sir, I have a small doubt as well.
Yeah, go ahead.
Since you were saying that we can use cyclohexamide, but since cyclohexamide blocks the elongation process, so will it be effective? Because even after using cyclohexamide for a brief period of time, there will be a little bit of initiation as well.
Yeah, you are correct. Those that were on the mRNA at the time when you added cyclohexamide, they will be arrested.
Mm-hmm. So we will reduce the signals as background in that case.
Yeah. Okay. Can you see my blank screen or no?
Not a blank screen, the screen with the blots.
Okay. Can you see it now?
No, sir. Sharing is.
Oh.
Sharing is.
Now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a cell. This is a receptor for a ligand. I add the ligand to the cell culture. Then there will be a transcription factor in the cytosol that will move to the nucleus. It will transcribe a set of mRNAs, which will get translated . These are all different kinds of proteins, okay?
Okay.
Some of them might be, you know, let's say this is another transcription factor. This can again go to the nucleus of the cell. And it will transcribe another set of mRNAs. Let us call this mRNA set 2. Let us call this mRNA set 1. Is it clear?
Yes.
Logically also it flows, right?
Yes.
How would you identify the set for mRNA 1 and mRNA 2?
If we could do it in a time-dependent manner.
Give me a concrete answer.
We will have this cell first and then we'll introduce the ligand. And if we know the time frame of the transcription and translation process, we can let it happen for a particular amount of time for the first set and then introduce cyclohexamide, and then we can like isolate the total mRNA and put it on a microarray to identify which all mRNA get translated. And for the second set, we can do it much later, if possible.
What if your timing is wrong? I need you to do a like design an experiment based on what you have been taught so far in a foolproof manner, that you will certainly be able to identify this set without any doubt.
So can I try?
Yeah.
Sir, we can do a, first of all, we will do a microarray to see like which mRNAs are expressed when we use this ligand. So that will help us to know that which mRNAs are present. And then we can do this experiment, which Ruchira has told, so that now we know the sequence of the mRNA, so we can do an RT-PCR or a Northern blot to see if these mRNAs are present.
Okay.
So do we know the transcription factor, the second transcription factor?
No.
So can you explain the later part of the question? I did not understand. After the mRNA translation, what is happening?
So as soon as you add the ligand, a transcription factor moves to the nucleus. There are such dedicated transcription factors, okay? It will move to the nucleus and it will transcribe a few mRNAs, okay? Now, it is always possible that among these mRNAs, some are encoding a new set of transcription factors. So once those transcription factors, like once the first wave of mRNAs are translated into proteins, some of those which are still translation factor, like transcription factor, they will move into the nucleus of the cell and cause a fresh round of transcription. I need to identify the first cohort, mRNA set 1 and mRNA set 2.
Okay.
And the key lies in, without a doubt, identifying the first set. And you should be able to tell based on what has been taught already. Anybody? You need to think.
Sir, after adding the ligand, sir, we will do microarray, and we will find all the mRNAs that are transcribed. And after that, we will do this. Then we will make two sets of experiments. In one set of experiment, after adding ligand, and in both sets of experiment, we will add ligand. Then first set of mRNAs will be formed. Then we will block translation by some, if we remove some initiation factor or... in one set, we'll...
Cyclohexamide is a good translation blocker.
Yes, sir. Sir, in one set, we will block translation by cyclohexamide. So second, that transcription factor will also not be formed and it will not go in the cell, and second set of mRNAs will not be formed. But in second set, we will not block translation. The second set of translation this transcription factor will form, it will go inside cell, and second set of mRNAs will be formed. And we will do next time microarray detect there that in this case, this second set of mRNA was formed, and in one case, that set of mRNA was not formed.
But here we are, you know, identifying the second set of mRNA, but how you are identifying the first set of mRNA, I did not get.
Sir, first set of mRNA we can identify by microarray. By-
After adding the ligand, when the first set of mRNA transcribe, we block that using the cyclohexamines. Then we perform the microarrays, and we find that first set of mRNA. And after we allow the translation, after adding the ligand, then we find the total mRNA. Then we find in our first mRNA set, then we identify what is the other mRNAs.
So, yeah, like what Ubed said, and then polished little bit by Kuna, that is the correct answer. That is, you add the translation inhibitor and immediately you add the ligand. If you do that, then no fresh translation can happen after addition of the ligand.
Yes, sir.
If any mRNA is synthesized at that time, they must be this set, right? Which did not require any fresh round of translation.
Hmm.
So you simply compare by microarray the cells with and without the ligand, both treated with translation inhibitor. Like a control experiment, in both you have the inhibitor, and in one, you have buffer, and in the other, you have the ligand. If you compare them on microarray, say after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you will get this set, right? Any doubt?
Sir, no, can sir. You repeat one more time?
That you have two sets, control and experimental.
Yes, sir.
In both, you added the translation inhibitor.
Yes, sir.
And immediately you added ligand, or the control for ligand is the buffer in which the ligand has been dissolved, that. So yes, this is actually without ligand, this is with ligand. And then you compare them on microarray, say after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, the mRNAs that will be present here, but not here, are these mRNAs, right?
Yes, sir.
And then you do the same thing without the, go for a little longer time period, and you see, but this time you will have your control and experiment will be, here you will have the translation inhibitor, here you will not have the translation inhibitor, and you will add the ligand in both. Okay?
Yes. Yes.
And then you look at a later time point, which mRNAs are coming up in the absence of the inhibitor, but not in the presence of the inhibitor. Then you will get that which transcription of which mRNAs are dependent on protein synthesis, fresh protein synthesis. Did you get it?
So in the first case, why do we need a control like with only buffer?
That is how all experiments are done. Like whenever you make a manipulation, you want to ensure that the only variable is the variable that you are claiming to be. So that someone cannot say that, the little bit salt that came from the buffer along with the ligand was the cause for the change.
Yes, I got it.
Yeah.
So yeah. In the first set, we'll also have the mRNAs whose transcription is not dependent on the ligand, like which were already, like by some other factors.
So that's why you are comparing. Na? When you are comparing, that set should be there in both the control and experimental, right? The existing mRNAs, pre-existing mRNAs.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir, I get it.
And sir, how will we differentiate in the second set of when we are detecting the second set of experiment by microarray that the first set of mRNAs have completely translated and the signal is not from first set?
Well, so in the case where you do not have translation inhibitor, so what you are are you saying that in this first set of proteins that are made, what if there is another signaling ligand and which is freshly signaling and that's why you are getting it? Is that what you are saying?
Not exactly, sir. I'm saying that if we are detecting the second set of mRNAs, what if the signal is also coming from the first set of mRNA that has not been completely translated? And yeah, there might be an alternate pathway that is operating and downstream it is leading to expression of other mRNAs.
How can we differentiate that? When you in the control, you don't have translation inhibitor, right? In the control,
mm-hmm.
you don't have translation inhibitor, right?
Yes, sir. So
everything that is supposed to happen will happen. But in the experimental, because you have translation mm-hmm. inhibitor, so this set of mRNAs cannot be translated. This mRNA one cohort. So any fresh transcript okay. that is dependent on this set of proteins, you will not be able to
mm-hmm.
find them. We will not
and
be
for
able
time
to
interval.
Distinguish. If you ask me, I will do half an hour, maybe 3 hours at max.
All okay, that we have to standardize it then.
Huh? Yeah, that you may want to
standardize. That has to be standardized.
Yeah, that you may want to standardize.
But will it be a foolproof method? I have doubt in the second part when we are detecting the second part of the RNA.
Yeah, it is fairly foolproof. You can vary the timing for addition of the translation inhibitor and you can show that after the appearance of the first set of transcripts, if you add the translation inhibitor, you will still not get it.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, in second case, the translation inhibitor that you added, sir, it should be specific to these mRNA.
Hmm.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah.
Sir, this in second case, the translation inhibitor that we added, sir, it should be specific to these mRNA, specific translation.
Yeah. Whenever I say transcription factor, I only mean specific transcription factor. Otherwise, I will say GTFs.
Okay, sir. Transcription factor. Sorry, sir. Okay, sir.
How does the initiation process occur in polysomes? No, so it is at the same cap. Multiple rounds of recruitment of ribosomes happen. Like how efficiently ribosomes are recruited to a cap dictates how good a polysome will be. Let me see if I can find something.
Sir, can you please repeat the question? I got disconnected in between.
Which question?
Sir, the one just now which you asked, the cap, polysome binding to the cap.
Oh, no. So, Navneet wrote a question in the chat box. I was answering to that and I have not completed the answer.
Okay, sir.
I am showing you my own data.
Yes.
Okay. So this is how. This is how polysomes look like. Okay. Can you see it? No, you can't, right? Can you see it now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is how polysomes look like, okay, on a sucrose gradient. And the way it works is that at the same mRNA end, at the same cap, the ribosome, multiple ribosomes are recruited. So the non-covalently complexed, you know, the thing now has one mRNA and maybe 20 ribosomes crawling on it. Okay, so what you can see here, this is monosome, this has two, this has three. This way we can actually see, if you know how to do a polysome profile well, you can actually get this kind of resolution, each differing by one or two ribosomes on one particular mRNA. Did you get it?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
And I had one more question as well. Can you hear me now? Well,
yeah, very clearly.
Okay. So, for the translocation between from one codon to other, you mentioned that the EIF2 should be GTP should be hydrolyzed.
Yeah.
So, for every translocation step, does the
one GTP is hydrolyzed?
Okay. So the exchange protein is involved for each and every step.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And, translation is energetically so expensive. That's why evolutionarily majority of the controls are at the level of transcription, because it makes very little sense for the cell to make the mRNA and then decide whether or not to translate it. I will upload a lecture tonight where translation control will be talked about. These are reserved for very special cases where you need instantaneous, action.
Okay.
So I have a little doubt in the initiation of translation.
Uh-huh.
The tRNA, there are two tRNA for methionine, right?
Yes.
For the initiation.
Yeah.
So one methionine that will be coding for AUG that will go and bind to the A site. But the one which is binding to the P site, what will be the codon for it?
Same, AUG.
So there will be two AUG codons in the beginning.
No. No. So that's what I tried to explain in the lecture, that for methionine, the amino acid, there is only one codon, AUG. Okay?
Yes, sir.
But see, it is the reverse case. For leucine, one amino acid, you have six different codons.
Six. Yeah.
But for one methionine, you have two different, the same codon.
But two different tRNAs.
Why do you need the two different tRNAs? They are though charged by the same amino acid tRNA synthetase. But there will be other structural features in the tRNA that will ensure that the one that is for recognition of the initiation codon, that charged tRNA will bind to EIF2, eukaryotic initiation factor 2.
Okay.
While the one that is to bring amino acid for the elongation phase of the protein synthesis, that will bind to EF1, the elongation factor 1.
Okay.
So that must be a structural difference at the tRNA level. Now, but amino acid is brought to the ribosome always as a ternary complex. Ternary meaning three components. One component is charged tRNA.
Yeah,
one
EIF2 and GTP.
Yes, the either EIF2 or EF1, and the third component is GTP. Now, when it is EIF2 bound initiated tRNA, at that time there is no 60S. Okay. So it
okay, will
to the 40S ribosome in a location that will eventually become the P site.
Yes, sir.
And that must be a combined property of EIF2 and other factors present in the 40S initiation complex, pre-initiation complex.
Right.
While when EF1 bound charged tRNA is coming to the ribosome, it is coming to ATS ribosome, where the A site is already there and open for an incoming tRNA.
So there are two triplets codons now, one for P site and one then for again for A site. Like the one first in the one, the tRNA which is for initiation, that is coming on the P site, and then the then again the next tRNA is binding on the A site.
It is the same AUG codon. Let me try. Let us see. This is the mRNA. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Here is an AUG and here is an AUG.
Okay.
At this AUG, the ribosome was loaded onto the cap and moved and is now here. Now onto this, your EIF2 GTP this will come and bind to what will be the future P site. Right?
Right, yes, sir.
The other one is already here in the P site. You already have a tRNA to which a polypeptide chain is hanging on to. The A site is open, and the same tRNA met, but this is the initiated tRNA. This is not the initiated tRNA. Will come and occupy here. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So, where was the confusion?
Sir, this is for eukaryotes, right?
Uh-huh. Eukaryotes, so, the same thing.
Same thing for prokaryotes also.
Instead of EF1, I think they use EFG.
Okay.
But the basic mechanism is the same.
Okay.
Anything else?
Sir, can you also discuss the question that you said in the lecture about, that since there is a anti-association factor, as you mentioned, the ribosome for prokaryotes, but not there in eukaryotes. So what experiment can be designed to isolate and study?
Bolo?
But sir, I don't have any. I didn't get the answer very accurate. I just tried. So I thought this ternary complex that comes and binds to the ribosome and it leads to the hydrolysis of GTP, and at that step IF3 is released. So maybe we can scan this step in eukaryotes and see if some factors are released. So I don't have any conclusive answer for this.
Okay, you answer in one or two words. What do you mean by an anti association factor? Plain English.
Anti-association factor that basically inhibit the association of two different entity. It prevents the association of two different entities.
It will not allow the large and small subunit to come together.
Yeah, exactly.
In bacteria, IF3, which is the anti-association factor, is associated with the 30S ribosomal subunit even in the absence of, ternary complex or anything, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And it gets dislodged only when
ternary complex comes and
binds, and no, even after that, when the GTP is hydrolyzed. GTP.
It basically dissociates after the hydrolysis of GTP.
Yeah, EF2 GTP. EF2 bound GTP, IF2 bound GTP.
Yeah. Okay.
So, forget about any initiation factor. If you take 30S subunit and 50S subunit, mix them together, will they form 70S or not?
If this IF3 is not there, then it will...
Yeah. Pure 30S, pure 50S.
Yes, sir. If IF3 is not there, then they will associate.
Now you take 30S, incubate it with IF3, now add 50S. Will they associate or not?
No, sir.
Right? Hmm. Now imagine that eukaryotes have such a factor.
Hmm. Okay.
Do you expect that factor to be present in the nucleus or cytosol?
In the cytosol, sir.
Okay.
Sir, because this process is largely part of cytosol of the cell.
So if you assume the factor to be present in the cytosol, if you take the small subunit, incubate it with the cytosol and then add 60S. If there is an anti-association factor, will they associate or not?
If it is acting as an anti-association factor, then definitely they will not, these two subunits will not associate.
And that is present somewhere in the cytosol, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So now you can fractionate the cytosol. Okay. Using different chromatographic techniques.
Yes.
And see which fraction maintains the anti-association activity.
Hmm. But sir, the point is here we have to, we have to already have some group of factors. We should have prior some guess regarding this.
Why?
Then only we can incubate. If we have, suppose, five different factors, then we can select.
No, never. Biochemistry discovered is never based on prior knowledge or guess. It is just like genetics. Biochemistry is also done blindly. You simply will use this much of logic that if there is an anti-association factor, that must be present in the cytosol.
Okay. So we will be taking help of cytosolic extract.
Yes. Then fractionate it and eventually you will get that one protein which is enough for causing the anti-association activity. And that was done, and no such anti-association activity is found in eukaryotes.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
So, since we know that few of the mitochondrial proteins are nuclearly encoded as well, and RNAs are coded from the nuclear mitochondria, they're
is it your connection or my connection?
Hello.
Something has gone wrong.
Sir, there are some proteins,
The
mRNA for which are transported from the nucleus to the mitochondria, and there they are translated.
Is that true?
Yes, sir.
I thought that the nuclearly encoded proteins, they are translated in the cytosol, and then they are imported into the mitochondria as proteins. I do not know if nuclear genes transcribed are imported in the mitochondria for their translation.
I have read about this example. I mean, I can share the source with you.
Please do that.
Yeah. So my question was regarding this only, that if the mRNAs are transported into RIA, how the ribosomal bacterial system.
That's an excellent question. I do not know. See, there are two possibilities, right? That the cap structure itself will be recognized in mitochondria. There is some mechanism which I do not think exists. Alternatively, is that though it is nuclearly encoded, but there might be a sequence like Shine-Dalgarno sequence, which is there, and that is recognized in the mitochondria. So until and unless I see the original paper, I will not be able to tell, because I am not aware of this thing happening.
Okay, sir, I will share the source after this discussion hour.
Sure. Okay. Shreya, bolo.
I have a question. Like for this translation, we have three sites, A, P, and E.
Mm-hmm.
So the incoming tRNA first comes to the A site,
mm-hmm.
and then the growing polypeptide is transferred from the P site to the A site. Transferred to the.
So the
tRNA is free at the P site. So it can exit right away from the P site, and why does it need to move to the E site?
While this peptidyl transferase activity is happening, at the same time the ribosome is moving little bit along the mRNA, so the empty tRNA is now in the E site. Okay. I am not a structural biologist, so you should not take my words as the final word on this. But I think that all these are happening kind of simultaneously. Okay. And we have identified something like an E-site, like Venki Ramakrishnan's group have identified something like the E-site from where the tRNA is ejected.
Okay, so it's from the structural basis that we are saying that there are three sites, even two sites could have sufficed.
I would not know. I do not want to guess that. It is a very well orchestrated thing, that it is moving and things are getting ejected or synthesized. So, yeah. Anything else?
And so for tyrosine, so for tryptophan amino acid, there will be only a single tRNA, because it has only a single codon.
Yeah, if it has only, does not necessarily have to be that. Tryptophan has only one codon?
Yes, sir. A single codon, yeah.
You know, I do not want to give you a definitive answer because I have never asked this question myself, that how many different tRNAs are there for tryptophan. But theoretically speaking, you can have multiple tRNAs for tryptophan that will, like, you know, particularly the one with the modified base, that will not violate any principle.
Okay, okay.
Okay, if there are no other questions, I will take your leave.
Sir, I want to ask one thing. I was trying to group codons according to verbal hypothesis. So for that condition, I was searching for those amino acids whose first two nucleotide is same, but the last one is helping in the verbal. So just thinking of if I take serine and arginine, so for them, starting the two start codons, nucleotides are same, but the last one is giving rise to a wobble. But like for, if you talk about serine tRNA, so for them, anticodon IgA, where it can complement with AGU or AGA or AGC, but if you're AGA, so it will incorporate arginine in place of serine. So I was thinking if this kind of situation arises, or if it is happening or not.
I'm sure it is not happening. Then all hell would have broken loose by now. Okay. Just because a possibility exists doesn't mean that it actually happens. We have understood a whole lot, but I don't think we have completely understood every aspect.
Okay, sir.
Chalte hain. I am extremely fortunate that I am able to sit and talk to you now. If you saw me in the morning, you would have thought that I am dead. I could not sleep at all last night. I don't know. But thankfully, I have recovered through the day. I'm glad that I could spend time with you. The quiz, I will try to do all the groups this Saturday. I do understand that some of you may be taking the CSIR NET exam on Sunday, on Saturday. What is the time for the CSIR NET exam?
Sir, it is in the two slots, morning also and evening slot also.
Okay, so those who are taking CSIR, so then maybe what we should do is I should conduct the whole quiz on Sunday only. I will talk to you. Oishi, are you there? No, she is not there.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Oishi, yes, sir, you can do that.
We should conduct the whole quiz only on Sunday. And I am informing you well in advance that this weekend I am a little bit pressed for time. So the questions will be less. And I want to spend no more than 7 minutes per student. Okay. And the questions will be only 4 groups. There will be 8 per group. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Hello. Bye-bye.
Okay. Sir, please upload the recording of this session because Promit has some issue with his internet connection.
I will upload the last discussion and this discussion and today's tonight I will record a lecture. I will upload all of it.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Good night, sir.